are looking for people that we can join the intercession roster. And so it's the area for those things. And office will be closed on Friday 10th. And will be open at the 9 a.m. Thursday 16th of June. Then faithfulness in service course happening 25th of June, and ladies' night happening at the end of June, 27th of June. So, and we are looking for the people who can just help us and join us the home visitation team. So, and we visit a lot of people, and more people want to see us. So we need more people, so please see Chrissy, and she's in the sound box today. And please see her if you love to visit people and have a chat. And there are lots of volunteers in need in the church, so please pray about it and join the team. is a great and first commandment, and second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, confident in God's forgiveness. Merciful God, our neighbor and our judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you and set you free from all your sins, and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of God, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer, for you are not the Holy One, you are not the Lord. You are the most high Jesus Christ, in the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. And prayer for today is second page on the PC. And let us pray together. Father, we praise you that through your word and the Holy Spirit, you created all things. You reveal your salvation in all the world through Jesus Christ, the Word made flesh. Through the Holy Spirit, you give us a share in your life and love. Fill us with the vision of your glory, that we may always serve and praise you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the ministry of the word.
The first reading is from Romans 8. Proverbs 1 to 8, verses 1 to 4, then 22 to 31. Wisdom's call. Does not wisdom call out? Does not understanding raise her voice? At the highest point along the way, where the paths lead, she takes her stand. Beside the gate leading into the city, at the entrance, she cries aloud. To you, O people, I call out. I raise my voice to all mankind. The Lord brought me forth as the first of his works, before his deeds of old. I was formed long ago, at the very beginning, when the world came to be. When there were no watery depths, I was in the earth. When there were no springs ever flowing with water. Before the mountains were settled in place, before the hills, I was given birth. Before he made the world of its fields or any of the dust of the earth, I was there when he set the heavens in place, when he marked out the horizon on the face of the deep, when he established the clouds above and fixed securely the fountains of the deep, when he gave the sea its boundary, so the waters would not overstep his command, and when he marked out the foundations of the earth, then I was constantly at his side. I was filled with delight day after day, rejoicing always in his presence, rejoicing in his whole world, and delighting in mankind. word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Psalm is 8 and it's on the inside of your pew sheet. I, Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name on the earth.
Majestic, your glory in the heavens.
Through the praise of children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, what is mankind that you are mindful of them? You have made them a little lower than the angels. You made them rulers over the works of your hands. The New Testament reading comes from Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 5. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, God.
was thinking about this message for us this morning. We worship an awesome God. Yes?
Yes.
We do. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And do you understand what that means? Well, I would have to say that I understand some of it, but I never understand all of it. Because our God is so mysterious, right? And I'll express that a bit later. But this came to my mind as I was thinking about it some years ago when I was up in Queensland, right out in the back near Winton. Anyone been to Winton? Right out the back, right? And we were invited to go after church to this person's house to stay the night. So we drive 80 k's out of town to his property, and we had a lovely dinner there. And I walked outside after dinner on my own and went out into the back paddock. And I looked up into the heavens and I saw the stars and the almighty universe right away. And I thought, wow, look at this. And there was no sound, there was no interruption of that sound, it was so quiet. And I thought, oh my God, look at this. Oh my God. We often say that sometimes, don't we? Oh my God, when something surprises us. That did surprise me. So how awesome then is our God? So I wanted to express that a minute. Oh my God. O-H, right? Really means reverence and awe and homage that we're paying to this God, right? Oh God. Next word is my. Oh my God. I wonder how often we think about that. When we get to say, oh my, we're saying, you're my God. I'm worshiping you. You're my God. You're my personal and intimate God. What an awesome privilege that is. And then we finish that phrase with God. God is majestic. He's powerful. He's mighty. Words we can never say enough words to express the God that we worship. So then, how awesome is that God? And we notice in our psalm this morning, Psalm 8, it begins with the words, O Lord our God, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. And David writes that in the end of the psalm as well. That verse begins, and that verse ends the psalm. He's expressing how majestic is God in all the earth. I read just recently of Mike Gatton, who was a test cricketer, right? Some years ago, in 1980, he was captain of English cricket in 1986 to 1988. I checked it up on Google, at the time, right? and there was a famous ball, bowled to him by Shane Warne. The reason I'm saying this is because Mike Gatting gave a eulogy for Shane Warne's funeral just maybe 7 months ago, right? But Mike Gatting once said this, because someone asked him, what do you believe in? He said, this is what he said, I believe in a bit of everything. God, the supernatural, ghosts, superstitions, UFOs. I like to keep my options open, he said. He's typical of many people today. Right? In today's pluralistic society, we need to know without a shadow of a doubt which God we believe in. So the early church found it necessary, after it began for quite a while, to make a statement so people know exactly what we believe as Christians, right? And I'm talking about the 3. We're going to have a look at that in a minute. And we can find that in our prayer books. It's on page 171 if you have a prayer book in your hand. The Apostles' Creed. We say the other creed, we're going to say that later on in our service, the Nicene. But I want to look at the Apostles' Creed. And it was written by the church fathers in those days to get people to be focused on the God, the right, true God. Right? I came across the definition of the Trinity, and I'll just read it to you. Within his own mysterious being, God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The designations are just ways in which God is God. Within the Godhead, there are three persons who are neither three gods nor three parts of God, but co-equally and co-eternally God. Now, if you know or understand all that, that came from the Christian theology of plain language. I read that just recently. Many years ago, in a little town of Capella near Emerald in Queensland, we lived there for some time, and we had a nice little fellowship. The church was called the Holy Spirit. It was a great little church in Capella. And one of the men there, his name was Jim, was in our Bible study, and we had some intense talking about God, but he could not understand the Trinity. God, three persons in one. And he would always come up with that. Jim would always debate that. He said, I can't understand that. We're not worshiping three gods, we worship one God, don't we? He couldn't understand it. He left the Anglican Church, he went to the Jehovah's Witnesses, he understood theirs. And I was so disappointed in that, right? That's the memory that just come back to me. So we don't truly understand the word Trinity, or what it really means. Now the word Trinity doesn't appear in the Bible, right? And there's no text in the Bible, but there is one text that refers to it. And it's in Matthew 28:19. It says, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. So that's three references to the Trinity. So the doctrine of the Trinity is not easily understood. How many of us can say we fully understand it? One God in three persons. And poor old Jim just couldn't handle that. I'm not worshiping three gods, I want to worship one. And he left the church. So give me a simple example. For example, I'm a father, I'm a son of my father, and a husband to my wife. Three parts of my person, the being, if you like. Another good example is water, steam, or ice. It's all the same thing. Different, right? So it is possible the element is exactly the same but three different forms of it. So therefore it's helpful for us to realize there needs to be some elements of mystery in the God that we worship. Because you see, oh my God, it helps us to realize, humble us, not this almighty God who we worship. Now, some knowledge of God we worship will help us understand who he is, right? But this Apostle Creed that I mentioned, we're going to look at it now very quickly, was written round about the 5th century when the church fathers decided they needed to write something, to construct something so people can keep focused on the real meaning, what God is, who God is. So, Apostles' Creed begins, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Now, if we only know God as Almighty Father, the creator of the universe, he can become for us a little bit distant, a bit holy, awesome, out of our reach and so concept of God is very similar to the God of Islam, to Abraham. You don't have any relationship with the God of Islam. He's too almighty. We have a relationship with our God. He is almighty, yes. But we have a relationship with him. Right? So, we want to sort of focus on this a bit more. So, he's the Father. We believe in him. Now, we don't worship God who isn't interested, I said, in relationship with us. He is. On the contrary, we worship God who wants to relate to us, and we want to relate to him. So that's why, that's when we pray, shortly. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. The Lord's Prayer. The prayer of Jesus, right? So we have, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. He loves us and he wants the best for us. He has a plan for you in his kingdom, and he wants you to accept and live in that plan. And for me too. The question for us this morning probably is, do you know God's plan for you? Do you know what God wants you to be? What God wants you to be? God has a role for every believer for his kingdom purposes. Physical age is not a problem for God. Not a problem. Remember, Moses started his ministry when he was 80 years old. So the reason many don't know what God's plan is because they haven't asked him. And we're encouraged to ask him in Matthew chapter 7. Jesus said, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and the door will be opened to you, for everyone who asks receives, he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks the door will be opened. We're to ask God. That's in our prayers. We have a loving Father God who we can trust absolutely, implicitly. The challenge for you and me, ask him. Ask him what he wants you. Ask him what he wants me to do. So that's God the Father. God the Son. This is the part of the Apostles' Creed, where we say, I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. The Bible tells us how God loves us. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 9 to 10, says, this is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. So we don't think of God only as Almighty God, whilst he is Almighty. He's a Father figure in that sense. But we also worship God who is a Son. Someone loving and personal with whom we can have an intimate relationship as we pray, as we seek his guidance and everything else. God's plan for us is to become like Jesus. Jesus said, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. We're to become more Christ-like. More Christ-like. So we worship the God, Son of God. His name is Jesus. And through him we have our sins forgiven. What a blessing that is. If it was an almighty God that a lot of religions worship, they don't have their sins forgiven because their God they worship is so almighty, it's way out of their reach. They can't have a relationship with him. focus on that part of it. So we're focusing on God the Almighty, God the Son, and then God the Holy Spirit. The importance of the Trinity is very important. That's why we have a Holy Trinity Sunday like we have once a year. Today is that day. The last one is God the Holy Spirit. And the phrase in the Apostles' Creed, we say, I believe in the Holy Spirit. It's worth reading and praying that prayer again sometime, because it's very personal. It's this is what I believe. This is what I really believe. Now, just before Jesus returns to heaven, he tells his disciples to wait for another helper, the gift of the Holy Spirit. A few days later, at Pentecost, they received that gift, and we celebrated that last week in the Pentecost. They're all filled with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is God in action in the world. He's literally everywhere in power, love, mercy, drawing us closer to him that we may receive healing and salvation. And so when we pray and ask for God's blessing, we pray for healing or whatever it is, we're praying this living God and the power he gives us, which is the Holy Spirit. Now the Holy Spirit can be likened to wind. It can be calm, but it can be strong and powerful. When the wind blows, we can really feel it. I can't see it, but we can feel it. Similar, that's a good image of the Holy Spirit. However, if we just focus on the Holy Spirit, we can get very emotional about it, right? It's sort of a bit emotional. We're relying on our feelings and our experiences. And say, I can't feel anything today, so God's not here. That sort of thing. This was a criticism of the early charismatic renewal in the 1970s and 80s. It got very emotional, right? And sometimes it got out of control. So why do we need to know what the Holy Spirit is? Is that we need to know he's part of the Trinity. The doctrine of the Trinity is intensely relevant for our faith today. We believe God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Holy Trinity, one God, three in one. We don't need totally to understand. We don't want to be like my friend Jim, who just couldn't understand and he left and went off to know some other religion. We believe God is in three persons. Holy Trinity. And that's what we celebrate today. It's so relevant for us. We need to keep us on the straight and narrow, if you like, the basics of Christianity. And that was written in the 5th century. And it's still very good for us to read it. And more than read it, we pray it regularly. So we make sure that we know who we are worshiping. Father, thank you for the opportunity to share this doctrine of Holy Trinity. Lord, it is a bit difficult sometimes for us to understand, but we want to just surrender to you today. Help us, Lord, just know that we don't really need to understand you totally. We need to worship you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Let us pray to God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Father God, all-powerful, whose Spirit helps us in our weakness and guides us to your Son in our prayers, we pray for the Church and the world. One God, three persons, be near to the people of the world, people formed in your image, created to live in relationship with you. Convict people across the world of your truth and love, blessing them that they may be a blessing to others. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for all who bear the responsibility of leadership, for heads of state, ambassadors, political advisors, and community leaders. Let your will for our world be accomplished through the decisions they make, and give them a vision of justice, peace, and reconciliation. For you, Lord, can find a way when men and women are lost. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
One God, three persons, we pray for your Church in the Grafton Diocese. We pray for Bishop Murray, all clergy, lay ministers, and church group leaders across this region. Draw them into loving and faithful service, that your name may be glorified. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all attending the Casillo weekend. Pour out your Spirit as they learn, worship, and fellowship together. As their love for you grows, so may their service in your name increase. Lord, in your mercy, Lord, we pray for our parish that you will continue to guide, inspire, and sustain us as we wait for the unfolding of your plan for this place. Lord, protect and nurture this community that we may grow a strong church, a healthy body of Christ, shining a light into our local community. Lord, in your mercy. One God, three persons, through your Holy Spirit, comfort and heal all who are in sorrow or need, sickness or adversity. We pray especially for the communities impacted by gun violence. We pray for those whose lives have been devastated by war, for those who still struggle to rebuild their lives after floods or other disasters, for those whose lives have been impacted by COVID-19, whether it be to their health or socially or economically. Let us pray for those known to us who are sick or facing surgery, remembering today Alan Moore, Bramway and John, Fran, and in your heart, name any known to you. Lord, touch them with your healing hand. Lord, in your mercy. One God, three persons. Be close to those who draw near to death. Have mercy on their suffering. May your peace and love dispel anguish. And hope in your glory dispel doubt and fear. Bring consolation to those in sorrow or mourning. Behold before you Beth, as she mourns the loss of her mother. Yet she continues to serve this parish in her time of loss.
us all a real sense of your love as you draw all who suffer into your tender care. Lord, in your mercy, one God, three persons, we ask you to lead us into the coming week. Help us to remember that in all we do and say, you are close beside us, guiding and enabling us when we trust in you. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen.
Jesus said, come to me, all who labour and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Let us pray. We do not presume to come to your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have these gifts to share. Accept and use our offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom. Blessed be God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Glory and honor be yours, always and everywhere, mighty and creator God, ever living God. We give you thanks and praise for our Savior Jesus Christ, who by the power of your Spirit was born of Mary and lived as one of us. By his death on the cross and rising to new life, he offered the one true sacrifice for sin, and obtained an eternal deliverance for his people. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, as they have in our hearts.
Merciful God, we thank you for these gifts of your creation, this bread and this wine, and we pray that by your word and Holy Spirit, we who eat and drink them may be partakers of Christ's body and blood. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. When he had given you thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup, and again giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Therefore we do as our Saviour has commanded, proclaiming his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. And looking for his coming again, we celebrate with this bread and this cup is one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Renew us by your Holy Spirit, unite us in the body of your Son, and bring us with all your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father, in songs of never-ending praise.
Blessed be the name and glory and power, and the Holy Spirit in heaven. Amen.
As our Saviour Christ has taught us, we pray together. Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be your name.
Break this bread to share in the body of Christ. We who are many are one body. Come, let's take this holy sacrament of the body and blood of Christ in remembrance that he died for us and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
continue your safe work among us. Give us courage for our pilgrimage and bring us to the joy you promise. Father, we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice through Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work in your praise and glory. And the peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty,